Have you ever twisted your ankle, wrenched your knee, or felt that sharp pain after a sudden movement? Joint and ligament sprains are some of the most common soft tissue injuries that we see, but if you don't treat them properly, they can lead to long-term weakness and repeated injuries. So in this video, I'm going to break down exactly what happens when you sprain or tear a ligament, the best way to speed up your recovery, and how to reduce the risk of it happening again. I'm Stephen Bunting. I'm a specialist MSK physiotherapist working in the UK. Welcome to my channel, where I discuss the common MSK conditions that affect everyday people and the evidence-based treatments that can help. When you sprain a joint, you're essentially causing a ligament injury. Sprains usually occur in hinge joints, such as the knees, ankles, wrists, elbows, and the small joints of the fingers and toes. Hinge joints generally have one plane of movement, flexion and extension. And in order to stop them moving excessively, they have strong collateral ligaments which support each side of the joint and prevent rotation and side-to-side movements. Ligaments are tough bands of tightly packed collagen fibres, which essentially act like strong ropes which support and strengthen the joints. Without collateral ligaments, hinge joints will be wobbly and unstable. But if we excessively rotate, basically twist the joint, or impose an aggressive sideways force, then we can overwhelm these ligaments and essentially stretch or tear some of their collagen fibres. And that's exactly what a joint sprain is. It's a stretching injury to a collateral ligament. So as I said earlier, it's the hinge joints that are most commonly affected in joint sprains, and particularly those collateral ligaments. And the three most common hinge joints to succumb to ligament sprains are the ankle, the knee, and the wrist. After that, it's the PIP joints of the fingers and the MCP joint of the thumb. The elbow is also a hinge joint, but it's very stable, so collateral ligament injuries of the elbow are fairly rare and are usually only caused by fairly major trauma. You can also sprain ligaments of ball and socket joints, like the shoulders and the hips, but ligament injuries around these joints are much less common, and in fact it's much more common to injure the tendons around ball and socket joints rather than the ligaments. So the most commonly sprained joint is the ankle. Indeed, most of us will have twisted an ankle at least once, especially if you've been involved in any running or jumping sports. So the typical injury is a sprain of the lateral ligaments, and they're sprained when the ankle rolls over into inversion. You can also sprain the medial ligaments in an eversion injury, but this is much less common. With the knee, the medial collateral ligament is the most common injury. It's usually caused when the foot is planted onto the ground and then the knee forcibly shifts direction, something called cutting in sports. It can also be caused when landing awkwardly from a jump where the knee twists suddenly. The other common way to injure the medial ligament is when the knee is hit on the outside surface, so a football or rugby tackle is a common cause. Here in the UK, an MCL sprain is one of the most common injuries that we see in football. For the wrist, it's usually a forced injury in any direction beyond the normal wrist range of movement, most commonly a fall onto a hand or a jarring injury like throwing, or like I did recently when swinging a golf club which caught a tree root, stretching my wrist backwards. For the fingers and thumb joints, it's usually a side-to-side sprain like this. So it's commonly seen in catching sports such as cricket or baseball, and also in falls if you catch your finger on something on the way down. So if you've sprained a ligament, then you're going to know about it. Ligaments don't just sprain without the person being 100% aware of the fact that they've just injured themselves. And that's one of my bugbears, because I often see referrals to my practice stating, for example, that the patient has a knee medial ligament injury. And yet when I see the patient, they can't recall any injury or obvious cause of their knee pain. And that immediately tells me that I'm not dealing with a ligament injury at all. So if you have a ligament injury, then you're going to experience that sudden sharp pain directly over the joint, and you'll be well aware that you've injured it. Ligaments don't get damaged at rest. They need some degree of trauma to injure them. Ligament injuries can be classified into three grades depending on the severity of the injury. Grade 1 injuries are often called simple or minor sprains. You'll get a sharp pain after the injury, but you should be able to move the joint afterwards, although it might be a bit painful. There usually won't be any swelling or bruising, and the injury should get fully better over a few weeks without much treatment. It's thought that in grade 1 injuries, just a few fibres of the ligament have been stretched. In grade 2 injuries, some of the ligament fibres will be torn, but crucially, enough fibres remain so that the ligament can still do its job of keeping the joint stable. Because we've now got some torn fibres though, the symptoms will be more intense and the recovery time is going to be longer. After a grade 2 injury, there will usually be some swelling and bruising, and indeed the amount of bruising and swelling is a good indicator as to how much of the ligament you might have torn. If it's a large proportion of the fibres being torn, then the bruising will be extensive. Grade 2 injuries will take a minimum of 3 weeks if only a small proportion of ligament fibres are involved. But the average grade 2 injury will take about 6 weeks to heal and sometimes up to 3 months in more severe cases. In grade 3 injuries, the majority of the ligament fibres have been torn, and so that ligament is no longer able to function normally and do its job of protecting and limiting excessive joint movement. We call this a ligament rupture. So in a grade 3 injury, the joint will be unstable, and indeed it's that instability which characterises a grade 3 injury compared to a grade 1 or grade 2 injury. So the affected joint might feel wobbly and unstable. In grade 3 injuries, the bruising and swelling will be widespread. And a common symptom that the patient often mentions is a popping or snapping sound at the time of injury, which essentially is the noise made as the ligament ruptures. Ligaments are really strong structures, so the forces involved in a grade 3 injury will be significant and often much beyond what we see in a simple twisted knee or ankle. There will have been a pretty major injury, typically the sort of thing we see in a road traffic accident or a high-speed, high-impact sports injury. It's also fairly common to have a fracture with a grade 3 injury due to the degree of trauma involved, so an X-ray is often done at the time of injury to check the integrity of the bones. Now, grade 3 ligament injuries will also usually go on to fully heal, but they can take 3 to 6 months, and the joint is going to need some sort of immobilisation and then graded support as it gets better. And if there's also a fracture, then this is likely to complicate matters further and affect the recovery times. So to summarise, this table just shows the differences between the three different grades of injury. So in grade 1 sprains, there will be mild local tenderness, probably no bruising or swelling, and no instability. In grade 2 injuries, there will be visible swelling and often bruising, noticeable tenderness, but no obvious signs of instability. Grade 3 injuries are where the ligament has ruptured, and so there will be noticeable instability, as well as all the other features of a grade 2 injury. So an MSK clinician can determine the grade of ligament injury by taking into account the nature of the injury, basically the forces involved, the amount of swelling and bruising, and then the degree of joint instability, which they can assess clinically. But for a more accurate grading, you're going to need some form of imaging. X-rays can check for fractures, but they can't see ligaments, so an MRI or an ultrasound scan will be needed if you need an accurate diagnosis, such as in professional sports, as recovery times can be determined much more accurately if the precise grade of ligament injury is known. For the majority of us though, a simple clinical assessment and grading will be enough to guide the rehab process, which brings us nicely onto treatment. Before we discuss treatments and expected recovery times, a quick word about finger ligament injuries, because they are a bit of an exception to the rules of all other ligament injuries. They just take so much longer to get better, and we're not sure why. It might be because fingers don't often get enough rest after injury compared to other joints, or it may be because there are so many pain nerve endings in the fingers. But you can pretty much double the recovery times that I'll be talking about for the other ligament injuries. So just bear that in mind if you do have a finger ligament injury. Okay, so let's start with a grade 1 injury, which is our simple sprain. Now, grade 1 injuries will typically take between 1 and 3 weeks to get fully better, and usually no particular treatment is needed. Just keep the joint moving as pain allows, but keep away from sport or strenuous activity until it's fully better. If pain is an issue, then a short course of painkillers, either tablets or gel, can be helpful. Okay, so moving quickly on to grade 2 ligament injuries, which is our moderate tear. Now, as I mentioned earlier, there's usually going to be some swelling and bruising with these injuries, and so an anti-inflammatory regime can be helpful, especially during those first few days. The RICE acronym is often recommended here, so that's rest from painful activities, ICE, an ice pack applied for 20 minutes every few hours to keep the swelling down, compression, so using a bandage or a neoprene support in order to contain any swelling, and finally, elevation, so keeping the affected joint elevated, preferably above the level of your heart, which can help prevent the swelling from tracking downwards due to the effect of gravity. So that's the RICE acronym, but there have been some opposing views within the sports therapy field as to whether this is indeed the best way of managing acute soft tissue injuries. And so I've done another video to explore these arguments in detail, and you can check that out up here, or I'll put a link in the video description below. But for the time being, for most of you, RICE will be just fine. And then as soon as the pain and swelling has reduced, usually 2 to 3 days after the injury, you should start to gently move and exercise the affected area as pain allows. And depending on whether it's a smaller or larger ligament tear, grade 2 injuries will usually take a minimum of 3 weeks, an average of 6 weeks, and sometimes as long as 12 weeks to fully recover. And if you rest it and avoid movement and exercise, then it will take longer. Remember, movement stimulates the healing and repair process. Motion is indeed lotion. Now, grade 3 injuries are where the majority of the ligament has torn, and it's now essentially not functioning as a ligament. So there's going to be some instability of the joint, and because of this, grade 3 injuries will usually need some therapy support and treatment and monitoring, because the joint will need to be immobilised during the first few weeks with a splint on or a cast, and after that, a support of some sort will usually be needed to protect the joint and the healing ligament while still allowing some controlled movement. And it can take around 6 weeks for a ruptured ligament to heal and the joint to become stable again. So, once the early pain and swelling have reduced by using the RICE regime, then you can start to move and exercise a grade 3 injury, but these will be very gentle activities which don't stress the newly healing ligament. So just really simple things like gradually increasing joint movement and just gentle loading exercises as pain allows. But as soon as the joint becomes stable, when the ligament has essentially healed, then you can start ramping up the rehab over a further 6 weeks or so. So a grade 3 tear is going to take an absolute minimum of 12 weeks to get fully better, and sometimes as long as 6 months. If you're involved in high-speed, ballistic sports like football, hockey, athletics, etc., then unfortunately you're always going to be at risk of ligament injuries. That's just the unpredictable nature of high-impact sport. And of course you can never control what other players will do to you either. But you can reduce your risk of ligament injury by training your joints in ways which mimic the types of activity required from the sport you want to do. For example, if you play football and you want to minimise the risk of knee and ankle ligament injuries, then your training programme needs to include football-specific drills. Sure, doing strengthening exercises in the gym will be helpful in getting your joints stronger and more resilient, but the act of playing football bears little resemblance to anything you will do in the gym, except maybe running on a treadmill. And of course, running is an important exercise for football, because that's the core activity, and you're going to need to have the stamina to last the entire match. But of vital importance are those exercises which closely mimic the action and forces that your knees and ankles will be exposed to whilst playing. So things like kicking, jumping, twisting, hopping, quick feet activities, and drills that involve sudden explosive changes in pace and direction. Even in a sport like golf, where wrist ligament sprains are quite common, doing exercises that expose the wrists and elbows to sudden forces and changes in direction can help prevent injury in the long term. Plyometric exercises like these can be a real game changer in helping to prevent injuries from high impact sports. They essentially put controlled stress on the joints and ligaments and encourage them to adapt and become more resilient to those sudden forces. And this can ultimately reduce the risk of overstretching or tearing the ligaments. They also enhance proprioception, which is your body's ability to sense movement and position. Better neuromuscular control means faster reaction times and better joint stability, therefore reducing those awkward landings or missteps that can cause injury. Okay, well that's about it. I do hope the video has provided a bit of information and guidance to help you with that acute ligament sprain and also to help prevent any further similar injuries in the future. So, best of luck in your rehab, and until the next video, take care. And bye for now.